Pentecost, as I mentioned in the announcement period, is coming on us very, very quickly. And as we will talk about on the Feast of Pentecost, we'll talk about the fact that it is also called the Feast of First Fruits. In other words, the very first that God is calling, you know, out of this world and into the church. And those are going to be in the first resurrection, which is called the better resurrection. And that God is calling us a small group. And in fact, Jesus Christ himself said that many were called, but few were chosen. Few were chosen to be a part of the church. That's why, by the way, of all the hundreds and thousands that hear the truth, only a few respond. But you know, what is amazing is of those that respond, of those that actually come into the church, how many of them endure to the end, which is another part of our calling. You know, the theme of the General Conference of Elders this year was the Live the Word. You know, last time we talked about laboring in the Word, studying the Word of God, but this time at the General Conference of Elders in Cincinnati, we talked about living the Word. You know, gaining the knowledge of the truth is of little value unless we live it, unless we put it into practice. The knowledge that we have is of no value whatsoever. You know, you can learn every day until your mind explodes. But if you never put anything into practice, what good is it? What good is that knowledge? Well, God commands us, brethren, to grow in the grace and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. But you have to have more than just that. We do have to live the Word of God. We have to live by the Bible and what the Scriptures say. And, you know, we must, in fact, do that in order to be among those who are going to be first fruits. We have to endure through whatever we go through in our lives to bring us to the end of the age and to the time when Jesus Christ comes and the resurrection occurs. Well, brethren, a fundamental element to continue to live the Word of God is the essential characteristic of perseverance. You know, if I leave anything with you after having been with you, you know, these years, brethren, in talking about all kinds of subjects from soup to nuts, you know, over the years, I hope I leave this with you, that the knowledge that you have, whatever that knowledge is that you've accumulated, unless you persevere with that knowledge, it will be of no value whatsoever. Over in Hebrews chapter 10, Hebrews chapter 10 at verse 36 and 37, I'd like you to notice what the Apostle Paul says here when he was writing this to the general laity of the church. And he says, "For you have need of endurance." That word endurance means, again, perseverance. "So that after you've done the will of God," you know, after you've done the will of God, "you may receive the promise." It's like any racer, somebody that's running a race, you got to finish the race to get a prize. You know, nobody's going to give us a prize, you know, unless we finish the race, unless we cross that finish line. And then Paul goes on to say, "For yet a little while," verse 37, "and he who is coming will come and will not tarry." You know, brethren, that word endurance, it is called perseverance in the New King James, comes from a Greek word that means steadfastness. Remaining steadfast until the very end. It means constancy. It means, again, endurance, as it's translated again in some translations. And so, brethren, since our purpose in life is to grow spiritually speaking, let's examine the reasons that we need to have this perseverance. Like I say, we must have perseverance in order to be a part of the first fruits. I want to read you some of the quotes that people who've become very successful in this world. Thomas Edison, of course, invented the light bulb, said that many of life failures are people who did not realize how close they were to success when they gave up. Now, wouldn't it be terrible to just almost get to the finish line, spiritually speaking, and give up before you get there? It's like I told you when I made a commitment to God when I was only a teenager. I said, God, I realize I'm nothing, but you know, if you will give me the help, I will make it across the finish line, even if I've got to crawl across the finish line, of course, to be in the kingdom of God. Vince Lombardi, who was, of course, the legendary coach of the Green Bay Packers, says this: the difference between a successful person and others is not a lack of strength, not a lack of knowledge, but rather a lack of will. You got to determine that you're going to do it. That nobody's going to keep you from accomplishing, you know, what you are called to do. And that with God's help, you will do it, even if you do have to crawl across the line. Winston Churchill, of course, all of us know Winston Churchill, but he said continuous effort, not strength or intelligence, is the key to unlocking our potential. It's what we do continuously. Now, I've mentioned to you about friends I had when I was at college. You know, the ones that really impressed me the most were those that were just, they weren't not the dynamite kind of people, but they were just, you know, very consistent. Very consistent. And in the end, you know, all of these, rabbits who were running the race, you know, like the story of the tortoise and the rabbit. You know, the turtle, even though he walks very slowly, he beats the rabbit because the rabbit gets exhausted. And he doesn't make it. But the turtle goes across the finish line. And, well, I guess that's, was it Aesop's Fables? The story many of you probably heard when you were growing up. Let's go over here to 2 Peter chapter 1. Over here, in chapter 1, in verse 6, brethren, we've got to be among the first fruits. That's why you've been called. When Christ said, many are called, but few are chosen, he's talking about those who are willing to persevere, who are willing to fight in order to be there. And you know, if we're not willing to fight to be there, then it's not important to us. Other things sometimes take people's interest more than the interest of the kingdom of God. I hope we're not one of those, but we want to be in the kingdom. We want to see a new world, a different world than the world that is out here. Here Peter is talking about how that we can make our calling and our election sure. And he talks about the different virtues that we need to accumulate as a part of our holy, righteous character in order to endure to the end, and to be able to be steadfast until the very end. But in verse 6 here, he says, and to knowledge, he's talking again about these characteristics, we add self-control. And to self-control, perseverance. Perseverance. And to perseverance, godliness. So again, it's something to build on, and one of the parts of our character that is absolutely necessary. All these are necessary that Peter's mentioning here to make our calling and election sure is perseverance. And again, as I've said already, Jesus Christ said that he that endures to the end, the same is going to be saved. He shall be saved. Those that are willing to endure to the end. Keep that in mind always, brethren. I know sometimes, brethren, as time goes on, we have our foibles, our problems that we battle on a continual basis. I know Mr. Armstrong was in his 90s. He was still battling with his own personal problems. I don't think that should shock anybody. I mean, we're all human, aren't we? If you're not human, would you stand up? I mean, we'd like to see. Maybe we'll meet an angel here. But one thing, a lesson that you learned about perseverance is that Godly character building takes time. You know, it's like Mr. Armstrong used to explain that one thing that God could not do in the entire universe is he could not create a character, holy righteous character, by instant fiat. You know, he couldn't do it by the snap of the finger. He could create the worlds. You know, he could create animals. He could even create us, brethren. But he could not put holy righteous character in us by instant fiat. It takes time. Spiritual growth takes time, brethren. But, you know, please be aware. It's like with our children when they're babies and they begin to develop. We expect them to grow, don't we? And that's why we do all the things we do for our children. We expect them to grow. You know, we don't have a 40-year-old man that still needs mommy or daddy in the sense of like a small child. We want somebody that's mature. Somebody that develops and grows. But spiritual growth takes time to develop. And, you know, and just receiving knowledge is not enough, again. That just is not enough. And people, I've met a lot of people through the years in the church, brethren, have been very knowledgeable. Very knowledgeable of the truth, but their lives were shipwrecked. Messed up. Paul, in fact, chastens, you know, the Christians in the book of Hebrews, when he tells them there, he says, for when the time you ought to be teachers. Wouldn't that be quite an indictment? If Jesus Christ were to come here right now, brethren, before all of us, and he were to look out over this audience, and he said, you know, really, for the time you have been in the church, you should be a teacher by now. Well, that's what he was saying. That was what Paul was saying. But he says, you have need that one teach you again, which is the first principles of the oracles of God, and are become such as have need of milk and not of strong meat. So, brethren, we need to progress, and God expects us to do that. And when the Son of Man comes, you know, the Bible says, shall he find faith? The implications of that scripture is that many simply would not endure to receive salvation. Because, see, when we begin to lack faith and we forget about having faith in times of trials, what do? We give up. We throw the towel in. So when Christ comes, will he find faith? Will he find faith in you? I'm talking about you sitting in that chair right now. Your name there. Whatever it is. Jim or Bob or Fred or whatever it might be. Will he find faith in you? God gives us time, too, brethren, to learn the basics of his word. He doesn't expect us to be 90-day wonders. He gives us time, a little time to find out what the water's like in the church. You know, he doesn't expect you and me, brethren, when we walk through the door, to start picking up songbooks and start helping out in that way. He lets us learn. He gives us time to learn and develop and learn how we actually can serve the church. We can fit into the church in the body of Christ. And do our personal part. All of us have a personal part, by the way, in serving the church. God did not call anybody without their personal part in the church. I think I'm more understanding that more and more, you know, as time goes on. But over time, we should develop through involvement in the body of Jesus Christ. We should become more Christ-like ourselves. And this cannot happen unless we persevere and we endure through the trials and the difficulties of the years that go by. You know, when I was called and I was baptized, I thought, because we were talking about back then, 1972. Boy, I guess I was called at just the right time. You know, here, you get baptized, and the kingdom is here already. Boy, if I had known when they put me under the water back in 1968, that I'd be standing here in 2016 in Oakland, California, of all places, I might have, turned tail and run back in those days. But, you know, we none of us did. We're still here, right? Because we believed it. We believed it with all of our hearts. Didn't let anything get in the way. Didn't let obstacles get in the way. But we kept going. We kept pushing. And over time, we understood more how we were involved in the church and how we could serve within the church. And through perseverance, maybe even through offenses, people may have offended us. We kept going. We kept applying. You know, Jesus said again, many are called, but few are chosen. And often those who are called just simply fizzle out because it's just too much. Sometimes people think the service is too much. I mean, you guys actually expect us to go to church every Sabbath. You mean you expect us to serve in the church? You expect these things of us? Well, they don't expect it, I know, in the churches of the world. But when people begin to think that way, brethren, what happens is they fade back into the woodwork of the world. Unfortunately, some people come into the church and they're like, they're just really dynamite, and they're so excited. But like the fog, they sort of recede. And pretty soon they're gone. Brethren, let's not be that. Well, let's not fizzle out. Let's be like that turtle that just keeps making the progress. And you'll come out on ahead if you have that attitude. So character building, brethren, requires perseverance. It requires time. Another thing about this, the need for perseverance, brethren, is character building involves failure. I know we don't like to fall down, do we? We learned that from the time we were little kids. We don't like to fall down. Of course, kids will show us how terrible it is when they fall down. It's worse, in fact, than they really think it is. But the bell ring would think, in fact, that you'd think they'd just died, if they fall down. But falling down, brethren, making mistakes, put it anyway, sinning, though, we should not sin, and God commands us to obey Him, we're going to sin. That's just all there is to it. But true spiritual growth, brethren, cannot occur unless we fail and then we get up, we dust ourselves off, we ask God's forgiveness, and we move on and we continue to obey. Again, God knows you will make mistakes and fail. But we must, again, each time, brethren, get up and move forward. And you know what? When we do that, we learn about ourselves every time we fail, every time we fall and we get up again. I know I have gone through problems myself. I've wrestled with my own problems. And I try to analyze, why did I do that? Probably, we're the only people on the face of the earth that do that. Now, why did I do that? And how can I keep doing that next time? Sometimes it's like Groundhog Day, isn't it, though? It's like the same thing happens every time. But pretty soon, when something really clicks in our minds about what we can do, we can overcome, we can change, and we grow and we learn through what we go through. Have you ever noticed about babies, how they learn to walk? We've had 5 grandsons, and they all go through the same thing. We've never had one grandson that was born, and you know, he came out and he said, "I'll have a steak." And by the way, I'm going to walk over here and, play with my toys. No, what happens is, as you know, they're like a slug when they're born. Forgive me for the analogy, but that's about right. They got to be fed. They got to be taught. They got to be instructed. And, of course, we know all of the other things that have to be done with little babies. And it's a long while before they walk. A long while. And when they start, finally, they start getting really agile. You know, what do? They get on the floor and they wallow around. You don't even have to mop your floors. You know, they'll do it for you. You know, just put some cleaner on the bottom of their shirt, you know, and they go around and clean the kitchen floor. They turn over. Pretty soon, though, they grab something and they start sort of pulling up those old little legs, sort of like rubber, you know. They flop back and forth. And then they stand, and they're really happy about it. But what's going to happen is they fall on their behinds. They don't give up, though. They persevere. Pretty soon they stand up again, and finally the legs start strengthening up there. And they take their first step. And, of course, Mommy and Dad are hoping they're going to be there to see this monumental moment. And then, of course, the second step, and then you got yourself a problem, because you got a child that's gone mobile, and destruction is on the way. Plug up all the sockets, you know, because you're going to find all kinds of things begin to happen. Is it the way we are? And we are spiritually, brethren, by analogy, a lot that way too. We fall down. But the key is you don't give up. You keep getting up. You keep pushing forward. You learn how to walk. At first, maybe you're flimsy in the legs, spiritual legs, but finally you get it. You don't let, you know, it's like a little baby. If they fall, imagine if they gave up on the first fall. Five, you know, little Johnny, he tried to walk once. He hasn't tried since. Not since he was 6 months, he hasn't even tried, you know. He's 41 now, you know, but it would be terrible, see, if it was that way, wouldn't it? But, and again, spiritually there's an analogy with that as well. I saw this story and I thought I would tell you about it. Just, you know, just because you have trials in life, you don't give up, you persevere through those trials. It's called The Donkey in the Well. It says, one day a farmer's donkey fell down in a well. And the animal cried piteously for hours as the farmer tried to figure out what to do. And finally he decided the animal was old and the well needed to be covered anyway. And it says it just wasn't worth it to retrieve that old donkey. So he invited all of his neighbors to come over and help him. And they all grabbed the shovel and they began to shovel dirt in the little well. That poor donkey, you know. At first, the donkey realized what was happening and cried horribly. Then, to everyone's amazement, he quieted down. A few shovel loads later, the farmer finally looked down and the well was was astonished what he saw. With every shovel of dirt that hit his back, the donkey was doing something amazing. He would shake it off and take a step up. And as the farmer's neighbors continued to shovel dirt on the top of the animal, he would shake it off and take a step up. Pretty soon, everyone was amazed when that old donkey stepped up over the edge of the well and trotted off. The lesson, brethren, is life is going to shovel dirt on you, all kinds of dirt. The trick to getting out of the well is to shake it off and take a step up. And so, brethren, think about that. Persevere. Instead of looking at reason to give up, shake it up, shake it off, and step up. You know, it takes that mentality, brethren, for us to develop holy, righteous character, to change, to overcome. You know, at all times, brethren, we should be striving to fine-tune our knowledge of the truth. You know, we've done, of course, numerous Bible reading programs to hopefully facilitate that for all of us to look into the Scriptures, to fine-tune the truth that we understand, to grow in the grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ, to fine-tune how we wield this sword, too, how we use the Bible. But are we able to give an answer of the hope that lies within us? And also, brethren, we should fine-tune our ability so that we can serve more in the body of Jesus Christ. God wants us to serve. Every one of us, again, should be involved in some way without murmuring, without complaint in doing so. Sometimes people want to serve, but they want to complain the whole time they're serving. Nobody wants to work with anybody like that, do they? They want to work with people that are there and they want to do what they're doing. Let's face it, brethren. You know, the job sometimes we do in the church are not, you know, going to give us a lot of glory. You know, it's like I remember at Ambassador College, we had one fellow that was he was over the toilets, and he had to clean the toilets. And of course, it was I think he was probably a freshman though. You know, he didn't start out as the chancellor of the college, you know, but anyway, he developed a good attitude. He decided he was going to clean those toilets, and then when he got them all sparkling, you know, he would call it a royal flush. So, but anyway, he tried to relate it to his calling. But you know, it's important to again keep our attitudes right, and to be willing to serve in the body of Christ without complaint. You know, if we got ideas about how to correct things, how to direct things, you know, it's good to give that input. Probably not on the first day that you serve, though. Probably not a good idea to start on the first day. Well, I've already figured out how we can do this better than you've been doing it the last 40 years. You know, not a probably good way to begin, you know, in serving within the church. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 9. 2 Corinthians chapter 9 here. 2 Corinthians 9, you know, Paul over here talks again about the matter of sowing and what we sow. We often use the scripture on the holy days, but in verse 6 of chapter 9, it says, "But this I say, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. He who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully." You know, the gist, by the way, of this scripture is talking about sowing and reaping. But, you know, think about this fact, brethren. What do you have to do when you sow something? You have to persevere to see it through until the time you reap it. So perseverance has to do with reaping. So once we've sown something, once we've done something that is good and we planted the seed, brethren, we want to be around through perseverance. We don't want to get discouraged over our mistakes. And oftentimes we make mistakes. Why do we make mistakes? We make mistakes because, brother, we lack experience. All of us lack experience in dealing with certain things in our lives. And our spiritual growth, brethren, is often two steps forward and one step back. And don't let anybody kid you. You know, you're not going to grow like this. You're going to grow. I mean, I wish we all did that. It wouldn't it be wonderful? In fact, it'd be great if it just go like that. But it's not going to happen that way either. It's not even going to happen you know, in that manner. It's not going to go up in a gradual way. It may go up, you know, and over. It may be like the stock market. You know, sometimes if you ever see that graph, it's up and down sometimes, but hopefully it's going up. And in the end, we want to make sure it's up. But again, it's two steps forward and one step back. Sometimes it's one step forward and one step back. But to the degree, brethren, that you and I make every step count, to the degree that you make every step count in your life, brethren, it will determine how fast you're going to grow. You know, whether it's going to be like this, or whether it's going to be like that, you know, going upward. So it's up to us to make that determination. It's going to dictate how fast you mature, spiritually speaking, and how fast you grow. Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2. Over here, again, failure is important when it comes to character building. You're not going to, in fact, overcome without failing sometimes. You just don't want to beat yourself up over it very long. But over here in Revelation chapter 2, in verse 4 and 5, just a couple of verses here that we're going to read. But it says, "Nevertheless, I have this against you." He's talking to the brethren that were of Ephesus. Remember, they were on that mail route in Asia Minor, the churches that are mentioned here. And it says, "I have this against you, that you have left your first love." You've left your first love. "Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the first works, or else I will come to you quickly and remove your lampstand from this place unless you repent." You know, all of us are compared to candles, lighted candles. And we want to make sure, again, that light is producing the fruit of light and shedding that light abroad. But God was displeased with the Ephesians because they left their first love. And he basically told them, he says, "Get back to the zeal that you once had. Develop that zeal that you once had." Second Peter. Let's go to 2 Peter over here. 2 Peter. Again, we don't want this to be a description of us. You know, Paul himself said, "I trust that you and I are not the kind of people that draw back, that pull back, but we move forward." And my experience with dealing with brethren in the Bay Area is most of them are that way. They're moving forward. They're growing. They're developing. And that's exciting to see. But in 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 20 through 22, you know, I mentioned about Mr. Pebworth and Mr. Crow and about Mr. Spears, but all of our elders have done a wonderful job. They really have. And the deacons and the brethren have done a wonderful job in the area. But let's notice here, 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 20 here, it says, "For if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world..." You know, after we have come out of this world that is a polluted, spiritually speaking, through the knowledge of the Lord, we learn the ways of God, the truth of God, and we come out of the world excited. And Savior Jesus Christ, that they are once again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse for them than at the beginning. God is saying here, if your eyes are open and you come into the church and then you leave it, you give up on those things that you have, the end is worse than the beginning. "For it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than have known it, to turn from the holy commandment delivered to them." See, Christ, brethren, delivered the commandment to you. You were given the commandment. I was given that commandment, or the calling that God has given to us. But it has happened to them according to the true proverb, a dog returns to his own vomit, and a sow, having washed to her wallowing in the mire. What a picture of that is. It's disgusting, isn't it, to think in those terms. It's like the old pig, you know, you get her all dressed up, and put a bow on her, take her to the fair, she wins the fair, the gold medal, and as soon as you put her back in the pen, she goes right over and lays in the mud pit. You know, you could feed her, you know, whatever you want, steak, anything. You could send her to, charm school if you wanted to. And she'd go back and lay in the... Hopefully, again, brethren, none of us. But it's like physical life. You know, about yourself, brethren, if you don't eat properly, if you don't get some exercise in your life, you're not a couch potato, and basically the only exercise you get is pressing the remote. You know, what's going to happen to such a person? You might be all right until you begin to get a little older, but eventually it's going to catch up with you, and you're going to get sick. So this is a fact of life. Spiritually speaking, unless, brethren, we are exercising, unless we are involved, unless we're eating the right thing, spiritually speaking, we will get spiritually sick again. But hopefully, again, we've learned that lesson, and we have persistently and consistently and with perseverance, brethren, applied God's laws so that we can be not only physically healthy, but spiritually sound in avoiding sickness. You know, character building also, brethren, and showing again the need for perseverance and building holy righteous character involves developing right habits. Right habits. Vince Lombardi said this, and I always kept it in my mind, this one quote. He said, once you learn to quit, it becomes a habit. You know what, I have to say that is the case of what I've seen in life. Is when you quit the first time, when you give up the first time, it's always easy to quit the second time. And subsequently after that, the character is torn down, so, you know, we become quitters. People can't hang on and continue into anything. No, God has given us, brethren, the spirit, not of fear, as Paul told Timothy, but of a sound mind. And he expects us to have self-control. You know, brethren, that Greek word for sound mind, if you go look it up in Strong's, is self-control. Self-control, discipline, sober-mindedness. In other words, when we do things in our lives, we're doing it in a sober manner. And when we think in those terms, and we're thinking in a sober-minded way, that shows we have the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. So, brethren, let's make sure, again, that we are developing right habits. I already read to you what Peter said over there when he talked about, you know, adding perseverance. He said, one of the elements, too, that makes it so that we'll be steadfast and that we will never fall is self-control or discipline. And let's face it, brethren, you and I need discipline in all areas of our life in order to live physically. We do. Got to eat right again. As I said, you need to exercise as well. Same is true spiritually speaking. We need to make it a daily habit to study the Bible. A habit to do that. And everything we do, Bible reading, everything needs to lead to the ultimate goal. The goal of the kingdom of God. Also, brethren, you know, in our personal lives as we build these right habits. You know, take small steps that each day that will lead to your destination. Don't try to take giant leaps. You're not going to become a scholar on the Bible overnight. But develop the habits and take small steps as you're working toward that goal. And eventually, you and I, brethren, will become scholars and experts. I think God's people know more about the Bible than any group of people upon the face of the earth. The ones that really had truly applied themselves. But again, we keep trying again and again, brethren, even after we fail. We get up and we keep going. So develop those right habits, brethren, and that self-control. Another thing, brethren, that is important and why perseverance is so important so that we can be the first fruits in God's kingdom. If you want to persevere, brethren, be around people who don't quit. Be around people that don't quit. You know, in fact, the proverb says that. You know, it actually tells us that. Let's go over here to Proverbs 27 and verse 17. I don't need to turn there. You can read it, write it down. But there it talks about how iron sharpens iron. If you want to be sharpened, you hang around with those who are doing the same thing. Iron sharpens iron. Who are you running with who has similar goals that you do and similar habits that you have? If you want to be good at physics, you talk with people that know about physics, right? If you want to know about something else, you spend time with people who know whatever it is you're trying to figure out, whatever you're trying to come to learn. People who understand, in fact. You want to be with people who understand about perseverance and how you got to stick with something. And who don't get discouraged. Who will encourage you likewise. You can encourage them. You think about, if you don't have somebody like that, when you get down, who's going to encourage you? When they're down, you can encourage them. So brethren, hang out with people who have a future. Hang out with people who have a future. And the Bible tells us not to forsake the assembly of ourselves together as the manner of some is. So much the more, it says, you see the day approaching. And it says that we are to provoke one another to love and good works. In Hebrews 10:24. So brethren, let's make sure again that we are hanging around, we're spending time with God's people. People that don't quit are not going to quit. They're not going to give in. You know, when Jesus Christ gave the parable of the man who came to the wedding in the wrong garments, in that parable he said, the leader of the wedding said, how did you get in here? You didn't have the right garments on. Well, brethren, we can look at the Bible, and the garments he's talking about here in the parable are the garments of righteousness, are the garments of involvement in the church. And brethren, if we don't have the right garments on, we won't be in the wedding in the future. So if we're going to persevere, brethren, we want to be around people who will not quit. And finally, brethren, the need for perseverance, brethren, in order to persevere, is you've got to always keep your eye on the goal. Keep your eye on the goal. Henry Ford said this. He says, obstacles are those frightful things we see when we take our eyes off the goal. I like that quote. When you take your eyes off the goal, then you see all these obstacles. It's like the spies going into the promised land. 10 of them took their eyes off the goal, and 2 did not. Joshua and Caleb. Got to keep our eyes on the goal, brethren. Nothing else matters. It's like when you're on the ocean and you're trying to navigate, you keep your eye on the goal. If you're plowing a field, you know, unless you keep your eye on a particular point, you know what that row is going to look like? It's going to be like that. But if you keep your eye on the goal, you'll plow a straight furrow, you know, in that field. So keep your eye on the goal, brethren, of the kingdom of God. Let's go to Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. Philippians 3 and verse 12. Well, let's go to verse 13 here. Chapter 3 and verse 13. Paul says here, therefore, he says, I'm in Ephesians. Let's go to Philippians. And, you know, I could read that all day long. They would never become Philippians. It's verse 12 of chapter 2 of Philippians. But chapter 3, I guess, is where it is. Forgive me. In verse 12. He says, not that I've already attained or am already perfected, but I press on, Paul says. I press on. I mean, you go back and look at the list of things Paul had to go through. You know, getting beaten. I would imagine for us, if we're in Paul's place, I think he was beaten several times. We'd have given up the first time. But Paul kept pressing on until his death. He says, not that I'm already attained or I'm already perfected, but I press on, that I may lay hold on of that for which Jesus Christ has also laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, not reaching, but he says, and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal of the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So he sets his eyes on the goal. And of course, there are going to be obstacles, brethren, but we can't let those obstacles get our eyes off the goal. You know, if you're thrown into a lion's den, you keep your eye on the goal. You're thinking about what the lions are going to do to you. You know, you might do things that you don't really want to do. Say things you don't want to say. So, brethren, these are important things. Perseverance to the very end is important to being a first fruits. A good beginning, brethren, is not enough. And great progress in the past is not sufficient for us, brethren. We need the characteristic of perseverance. For you have need of endurance, the Bible says, that after you have done the will of God, you may receive the promise. But remember what Paul goes on to say, for yet a little while, we keep enduring, brethren, and he who is coming will come and will not tarry. Now the just shall live by faith, but if anyone draws back, Paul says, my soul has no pleasure in him. But of course, he goes on to say, but we are not of those that draw back to perdition, but of those who believe to the saving of the soul. So, brethren, let's persist. Let's persevere so that we can be first fruits ahead of us when the first resurrection takes place.